The Key of David vision is the greatest vision in the entire Bible. Learn how this universe-shaking vision unlocks the future of all mankind. Next, on The Key of David with Gerald Flurry.
Greetings, everyone. Revelation chapters 1 through 3 discuss seven eras of God's church, and you'll see from Christ's first coming until his second coming, there are seven church eras. Now, that's explained in my booklet on the true history of God's true church. And all of our literature is free, and so if you have any questions about that, they certainly would be answered in that booklet. The last two eras, number 6 and 7, are given only one message, to deliver to this world, and that message is the Key of David. So we have even named our program the Key of David, which is played every weekend. But the book of Revelation puts all prophecy in time sequence, and that's what he does with those church eras. He'll take 1 through 7, all the way from Christ's first coming down to the second coming, and that covers a period of 2,000 years. So why is this so important? Why is it important to me or to you? Now again, this is the only message that Christ gives these last two eras to proclaim to the world. So what is a Christian? A true Christian is one who follows Jesus Christ, does what he says. There's one in one of the Gospels, he says, "Why call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" So we have to follow Christ's teachings and do what he teaches us to do. Verse 7 of Revelation 3 says this, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things says he that is holy and he that is true and he that has the key of David, he that opens and no man shuts and shuts and no man opens." So here is again is that only message. No man can open, no man can shut. It's all Christ doing. It's all what he does. Verse 8, "I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door, and no man can shut it. For you have a little strength and have kept my word and have not denied my name." So these people kept God's word, and he said, now if you proclaim this message, I will open up a door for you to deliver it to this world. If you will just deliver that message about the key of David. And what is that all about? Do we really understand that? Verse 10 says, "Because you have kept the word of my patience, I will also keep you from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth." This is like a double warning. It's going to all the world, to everyone on this earth. And so, if we only have deliver this message, God says, now I will protect you from all these terrible problems that are coming upon this world and the terrible suffering that's coming upon this world if they don't wake up and yield themselves to God's word. There is going to be a lot of serious trouble, and it all leads, though, to the second coming of Jesus Christ, which is the best news we could possibly hear. So this message is very critical, and if you go to even the Gospel of John, the first chapter, he explains all of this as well. But let's look at Luke 1, verses 30 through 32. Verse 30, "And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you shall conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the eternal God shall give unto him the throne of his father David." Well, here is the Father giving the throne of David to his Son, Jesus Christ. Now, if you look at that closely, you can see that this is a family message. The Father gives this throne to the Son, and the Son proclaims the Father's message, and it is all a family message that is opened up to all mankind so that they can become sons and daughters of God as well, the very family of God. Verse 33, "And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." No end. Christ is about to rule over this earth. And he's invited every man who's ever lived before it's over to be a son born into his kingdom. That is what God offers us. And those first fruits that are called out and used before Christ returns to this earth are going to be rewarded by actually being given, well, the opportunity to sit on David's throne with Jesus Christ himself. That's quite a reward. And that you'll receive if you deliver this message of his before Jesus Christ comes to this earth. And then let me just quickly read to you what it says in Genesis 49. We'll go back to the very first book of the Bible, and it talks about, of all things, the key of David. Notice verse 1 of chapter 49. "When Jacob called unto his sons and said, Gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days," are the days we're living in right now. Here's what he says, verse 10, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come," or Christ comes, "and unto him shall the gathering of the people be." So this is the scepter promise. This is the promise that God made to David that he would always have a man or woman sit on his throne, a descendant of David, from the time of David all the way down to the second coming, and really leads into the second coming of Christ, where God is going to give salvation to all mankind. That's the end result of David's throne. So here you have many places in the Bible that it talks about the key of David, many places. And this is the only message that God gives his people to proclaim to this world, the only one. Now, and he gave that to the last two eras of his own church. Of course, this promise to David is about race and grace. In other words, it's descendants of David that are sitting on that throne of David until the second coming of Jesus Christ. And then, of course, Christ comes and gives grace or offers salvation to all mankind who has ever lived on this earth. Of course, that will be done through some resurrections as well. But that's what God is going to give all mankind. So what does the key of David unlock? What does it unlock? Well, I want to give you one of the most inspiring examples in all the Bible that talks about that. And anciently, there was a lady who changed the course of Israel's history because of what she did. Now, she had a powerful vision. If you just think about this, a powerful vision on the key of David many decades before David was even born. Now, see, in other words, this message begins long before David. But this lady was given a powerful vision from God. And you can read that in 1 Samuel, that's one of the former prophets. And of course, the former prophets are prophecy primarily for this end time. So we have to keep that in mind. This is in the former prophets. It's prophecy and mainly for this end time. So the everything just really centered around Shiloh at this time in ancient history. But notice what it says in 1 Samuel 1 and verse 3. And here's this amazing example. A man named Elkanah had two wives, and this man went up out of the city yearly to worship and to sacrifice unto the Eternal of Hosts in Shiloh. It goes on to say in verse 5 that God shut the womb of one of his wives. He had two wives, and so she did not have a man-child, which is what she wanted. Then in verse 8, well, her husband was pleading with her and saying, well, look, I'm looking after you. That should be satisfying for you. So don't be so concerned about having the son. It was beginning to unnerve him a bit. But this lady just went to the tabernacle in Shiloh where the whole nation was led because the Ark of God was there. But she was there in the tabernacle just imploring God to give her a son. And she said, if you give me that son, I will have him, make him obedient to you as much as I can and give him to you to serve in Shiloh in the tabernacle for the rest of his life. And he'll take the Nazarite vow and all of that. She really was determined. And the amazing thing about it is that God answered that prayer. She went to God in faith and said it, and she followed up and did it. And God knew this woman had real faith, and he heard that message or that prayer. He heard that. She said that her son would abide there forever. And she was doing that in faith. So here is a prayerful psalm that I want to read to you. And it is Hannah's prophecy, really. And this is just some of the most amazing prophecy you'll ever read in the Bible. Notice what it says. You can read the beginning of it in 1 Samuel 2, verses 1 through 10. And you can read all of it there. But verse 6 says, the Eternal kills and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and brings up. She had that kind of faith. In verse 8, he raised up the poor out of the dust. He lifted up the needy from the dunghill to make them sit with princes and inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. Now she knew God was going to build some pillars before his second coming, or Christ's second coming. And he said that God is going to take those pillars and he's going to set the world upon their shoulders. They're going to rule this whole earth. Those people that are called out before Jesus Christ returns to this earth and heed that calling. And that's the reward that God is going to give them. He's going to set the whole world upon their shoulders. Now that is the reward God is going to give these people. And Hannah saw that in a vision that God gave her. She understood that. What a reward that was. But she says, he's going to take the people from the dunghill, the very lowly of the world, and he's going to make pillars out of them, and he's going to rule the world with those people who are going to share David's throne with him. That's called the Bride of Christ. So do we believe God? Do we believe he's really going to have those pillars and that's going to happen? Well, notice what it says in verse 10. Here's the promise that God has made. The Eternal will judge the ends of the earth, and he will give strength unto his king and exalt the horn of his anointed. Now, what does that mean? A king and the anointed. Well, first of all, she's talking about King David. She passes over Saul, and she knows that God is going to bring King David into his plan. This is many, many decades before David was even born. And she understood that and made this prayer and this prophecy before God. You can see what God does to people who really step out and believe him and apply what he says. And if we're receiving a lot of knowledge, what are we doing with it? We have to apply it as Hannah did if it's going to really make a difference in our lives. So here she's talking about the house of David and the throne of David, and that leads right down to, she shows in these verses, that it leads right down to the Messiah, the coming of the Messiah, and the second coming of Messiah here she's focusing on. And she says now, and she goes on and talks about that this David is going to be anointed as king. And she's prophesying here is that, look, and she even says, if you look the context, that her son is going to do that anointing. And so he anointed David 16 years before he ever was coronated. And so he had Saul chased him and tried to kill him because he knew what God had promised to David. And he didn't like that at all. But this key of David's vision is right there. It was in Hannah's mind. That key of David's vision, and the core of that is the throne of David. And it opens up so much. What does it unlock? What does that key unlock? Well, let's take a look at the second part of that where it talks about the anointed. So David's throne was, she knew about many decades before he was born, but the same is true of this anointed, the priest that was anointed. He's going to have the same experience that David did. Hannah had this revealed to her in her prophecy and her prayer. Notice what it says here in verse 17 of this 1 Samuel 2 chapter. The sin of the young men was very great before the Eternal, for the men dealt contemptuously with the offering of the Lord. So things were going wrong, and something had to change in Israel. They were forsaking God, and they were being cursed. And it was really bad in Israel at that time. But remember, much of this, most of it, is primarily for this end time. That's what these former prophets are all about. And you can see that many places, even in Genesis. It tells you it's going to happen in the last days, the days we're living in right now. So she began to change the course of history. And I will raise me up a faithful priest that shall do according to that which is in my heart and in my mind, and I will build him a sure house, and he shall walk after mine anointed forever. That's 1 Samuel 2 and verse 35. A priest is going to be on the scene. This priest is going to be there, be loyal to David forever. He replaced Abiathar as the chief priest there, or the lead priest. And all the other priests before Zadok, but Zadok stayed with David and focused on David and never left David because he had that key of David vision. He knew that God was working with David, and he looked to God and he trusted God the same way Hannah did. And God says there was going to be a great reward for him. And all of this was happening even 100 years after Eli died, and his sons were had a lot to do with corrupting Israel. And so God didn't treat him well at all and punished him for his sins. But then it says in really that this faithful priest is going to be loyal to David's throne forever. David was given a lot of fiery trials, and he rejoiced in them, and he became king, and Zadok was right there with him. And what does Zadok have to do with us today? Well, now, Zadok certainly was a great man anciently, but still the main part of this is for the end time, because many more eternal lives are at stake in this end time if they don't obey God, many of God's own people. And he says there are some sons of Zadok in this end time that have the same spirit that the ancient Zadok did, and they are loyal to that key of David, or loyal to the throne of David, and God rewards them mightily for that. Let me show you that. Again, the sons of Zadok, This was many decades before Zadok was even born, and Hannah was talking about that and prophesying that. And God really used that woman in an amazing way. She delivered God's message, and here we begin to get into a subject about the sons of Zadok. What is this opening up to us? It's really opening up the entire Bible. That key of David opens up the whole Bible to us, everything. And it all goes back prophecy here, goes back to the time of Samuel, when they entered into the time of Joshua and Judges, which is also the former prophets. So we need to remember what the sons of Zadok are all about, because they play a key role in this end time as well. And Zadok just foreshadows an end time, and Hannah knew about this end time and the sons of Zadok as well, because she said God is going to make pillars and he's going to set the whole world upon those first fruits and those sons of Zadok in the end time, all of the first fruits. And he's, because he has taught them to be pillars and to be teachers to this world. And that's where what must be happening to us today if we're going to be sons of Zadok. This faithful priest that she prophesied about. Notice Ezekiel 44 and verse 15. But the priests, the Levites, the sons of Zadok, that kept the charge of my sanctuary when the children of Israel went astray from me. 95% of God's people turned away from God in this end time. And that's what this is talking about. Ezekiel is an end time prophetic book. They all went astray from me, 95% of God's people, but these sons of Zadok shall come near to me because they stayed loyal to David's throne in the key of David. And he says they're going to minister to me, come near to me in the world tomorrow in that temple of Ezekiel. And they're going to come near to me, and they shall stand before me and to offer unto me the fat and the blood, says the eternal God. Now, this is the reward God gives to these sons of Zadok who are loyal to the throne of David and the key of David, which is just a fuller picture of it all and what the Bible is all about. And if you want something to unlock the Bible, well, this is the key, and there's only one key. Verse 16, they shall enter into my sanctuary, and they shall come near to my table to minister unto me, and they shall keep my charge. They're going to work directly with Jesus Christ when he returns to this earth. And they're going to be near him, and they're going to be at his table, and they're going to be close to him because they're serving him forever at headquarters at the time of Christ, and then later at the time of the God the Father after New Jerusalem comes down to this earth. But Hannah saw that all of these people were going to be pillars in the temple of God, pillars for God forever. And that's what Zadok is all about. She talked about this priest and a king in Revelation 1 and verse 6 says that we are already kings and priests in embryo. And Christ talks about them as if they were already in the kingdom, born into God's family. That's how much faith God has in his plan and what he's going to do with these people and all of the first fruits, and he will do with anybody who yields themselves to this work and gets the message of God out to this world, this great, great message about the key of David. Until next week, this is Gerald Flurry. Goodbye, friends.
Request the former prophets to learn how to build Hannah's deep vision of family. Also request the God Family Vision and the True History of God's True Church. All our literature is available free of charge at no cost or obligation to you. Order now. The preceding program was a paid presentation of The Key of David, brought to you by the Philadelphia Church of God.